Finally tonight, we return to our Economist Film Project series with a film called Crime After Crime. It documents the dramatic legal battle to free Deborah Peagler, a woman in prison for more than two decades for the murder of her abusive boyfriend. She finds hope for freedom when two attorneys step forward to take her case on a pro bono basis. The director is Yoav Potash. Here is an excerpt.
Hi.
My name is Deborah Peagler, and I was convicted of first-degree murder, sentenced to 25 years to life.
Nadia Costa and I began representing Deborah Peagler shortly after California became the first state in the nation to adopt a law specifically designed to help incarcerated survivors of domestic violence win their freedom. It's a huge problem, a national problem, probably an international problem, and this law is just the first step. Debbie was connected to the murder of the man that abused her, but the evidence of that abuse was never presented to the court. And if she had been charged appropriately, she would have served a maximum of 6 years in prison. Instead, by the time we took her case, she had already been in for 20 years and been denied release by the parole board twice.
This isn't a case where Debbie Peagler didn't have anything to do with the crime. But when you look at all of the facts and circumstances surrounding what occurred, any reasonable court, any reasonable parole board, and any reasonable person would conclude that she has served enough time and she should be released from prison.
He had got to the point where he would stop hitting me with his fist. He would make me lay on the floor, or lay on the couch, or whatever, and beat me with a bull whip. And so I'd have whips all on my body. Never hit me in my face. Didn't want to mess up the face, because I had to be his perfect hostess for his friends. But I could easily wear long sleeves or whatever, cover up the bruises.
Debbie tried to escape Oliver on numerous occasions, but he kept bringing her back by force or by death threats.
Debbie's mother suggested to Debbie that she let Ramon Sibley and little Timmy Lively make Oliver leave her alone.
Sibley and Lively were Crips gang members that controlled the area where Debbie's mom lived. It was their turf. And when Oliver showed up with a group of armed guys threatening to kill everyone in their neighborhood, that was the last straw. That wasn't going to happen on their watch.
I mean, you see that all the time.
The extreme I used to see him go to, grabbing her, choking her, socking her. He used to beat on her like she was a guy, you know? So two or three times I had to beat on him like he was a guy, you know? And just to one, to try to protect her, and two, to show dude that this is what you're doing to her.
You know, I was like, you guys gonna make him leave me alone? Will you just make him leave me alone? And I was like, yeah, let us handle it. We'll take care of it. Okay.
After Oliver Wilson was killed, Debbie did receive about $17,000 in life insurance proceeds, most of which went to Oliver's mother and to pay for a very elaborate funeral for Oliver. And the Los Angeles County District Attorney's Office took this evidence of life insurance as proof that Debbie had Oliver killed for financial gain.
You know, I sit in prison wondering, was there a better way? Was it a different way? Like today, I know there is, you know, there's shelters and, you know, people out there available now. Where were those people at then?
In 1983, when Debbie Peagler went to prison, the battered women's movement was still in its infancy. There were just starting to be battered women's shelters. It was the very beginning of having restraining orders.
Over time with committed activists, they started bringing victims out of the shadows to share their stories. And police became educated, and the general public became educated about this issue.
5 years passed, 10 years passed, people started talking about battered women's syndrome. They even started a domestic violence program at the prison and group therapy.
They're always talking about the victim that died in our case, but we're a victim too.
He beat me till it was black and blue.
And this was the only way I could ever get away from him.
When Debbie Peagler was sent to prison, the number of incarcerated women nationwide was less than 20,000. In the years since, that number has just plain skyrocketed, so that today there has been a more than six-fold increase in the number of women in prison in less than 30 years. Many of these women, especially those who are serving life sentences like Debbie, are incarcerated for a crime that is directly related to that abuse. After decades of advocacy, battered women in prison and their supporters on the outside were finally successful in getting this habeas law passed in California. It's the first law in the nation that allows domestic violence survivors to present their evidence and finally have a real chance at winning their freedom.
I think it's astounding that California is the only state that is actually allowing cases to be reopened, because there are thousands and thousands of Debbies across the United States.
Even in California, the state is not providing these women with attorneys, and so the Habeas Project formed to connect women with attorneys who could take on these cases for free. That's how we found Nadia and Joshua for Debbie, and they have been amazing.
Getting the prosecutors to agree that Debbie should be released did not happen overnight. It took more than 3 years to get them to see the light, and it was at that time that we were able to walk into that prison and give Debbie that letter.
We have bad news and we have good news.
Okay.
The bad news is you've apparently been incarcerated illegally. The good news is the DA has agreed that your crime was voluntary manslaughter, which means your maximum sentence would have been 6 years under the guideline, the penal code section that was in effect at the time. We're going to work with you, explain what it means, what the next steps are, and how we can.
So this is from the LA District Attorney's Office. You presented significant issues and evidence which were unknown or unavailable at the time of trial. Once the matter has been returned to the jurisdiction of the Los Angeles Superior Court, this office would be willing to offer a plea to one count of voluntary manslaughter in violation of Penal Code Section 192A with credit for the years of imprisonment served thus far. Such disposition satisfies our office policy of requiring a plea to the charge which most accurately describes the defendant's criminal conduct. In context, it also serves the interests of justice.
Oh my God. This is really happening.
It's really
like, you knew it could happen, but it's really happening.
I had absolute faith that letter meant the DA would do the right thing and that we would see our client released, you know, very shortly. I had no doubt that it would happen.
We filed our habeas petition based on that deal, and a few weeks after filing our habeas petition, we received a letter from someone in the district attorney's office that we'd never met before saying, the deal is hereby withdrawn.
The prosecutor's office refused comment, citing pending litigation. That litigation filed today by Peagler's attorneys.
We have asked the parole board to reconsider their last finding. The DA's office, we're suing them to force them to stick to their deal. And we're appealing the Superior Court's denial all the way up to the Court of Appeal in the hope that they're going to direct the court to do the right thing.
There's a reason that your case is going to draw attention to this remedy.
Free Debbie now! Free Debbie now! Free Debbie now!
The victim's family, the Wilson family, has no objection to her coming home. They've been went to every parole hearing for the last probably 6 or 7 years, pleading with you all to let her come home. So if they have no objection to it, who are you to keep her in there?
California remains the only state that lets convicted and imprisoned survivors of domestic violence petition the courts for their freedom. You can watch Crime After Crime tonight on the Oprah Winfrey Network at 9 p.m. Eastern Time. To learn more about the Economist Film Project and to submit your own film, head to film.economist.com.